Impetigo is a contagious local superficial infection involving the epidermis. Let us now recap the anatomy of the skin to understand impetigo in general. So the skin has two main layers. This is the epidermis on the top and then the dermis under it. Below the dermis, you have subcutaneous tissue, which makes up what's known as the hypodermis, which is also actually what's known as the superficial fascia. Below the superficial fascia, you have the deep fascia, which is a connective tissue layer which surrounds organs such as your muscle over here. In the hypodermis-dermis area, you find the skin artery and veins, which project capillaries all the way up to the base of the epidermis. You also find sensory nerve fibers, which go all the way up to the base of the epidermis as well, and you have different types of sensory nerve fibers. Impetigo classically presents in children. And so the risk factors of impetigo include children. And because impetigo is contagious, risk factors include poor hygiene and overcrowding. Also, contaminant skin diseases such as dermatitis can be risk factors. The classical presentation of impetigo is a child presents with lesions, crusting lesions around the mouth or in the upper limb, such as your hands. Let's take a closer look at what happens in this area. What you see are small blisters forming, vesicles. Actually, it can also be pustule, which are usually thick-walled, but these can rupture. And when they rupture, they leave a yellow-brown crusting lesion around it. And this is a classical feature of impetigo. And again, it only involves the epidermis. And so impetigo is an epidermal bacterial blistering skin infection. The causative agents of impetigo, the main one is Staphylococcus aureus, which is a gram-positive cocci. The second include beta-hemolytic streptococci, which is a group of streptococci, including group A streptococcus, also known as S. pyogenes. You also have a sort of uncommon cause, which is Pseudomonas aeruginosa, which usually occur in hot baths because, again, it is contagious. Impetigo can be classified into two types. These are non-bullous impetigo and bullous impetigo, and the name says it all. Essentially, the example I gave to you of that child with the crusting lesions, blistering lesions around its mouth, is an example of non-bullous impetigo because they involve small blisters. The feature of a non-bullous impetigo is the honeycomb crusting appearance, no bulla present, which are your big blisters, as well as it not being painful because it's more in the superficial part of the epidermis where it doesn't get in contact with the sensory nerve fibers. Bullous impetigo, on the other hand, is different. So if we're to draw it out again, bullous impetigo involves formation of a bulla, which is essentially a big blister. But again, this is only confined to the epidermis. Because it is so big, the blister can actually cause irritation because it's very close to the sensory nerve fibers. Bullous impetigo is characterized by vesicles, the small blisters, bulla, the big blisters, and it being irritating. Let's now learn about the pathophysiology of impetigo by focusing on bullous impetigo as an example. The main causative organism of bullous impetigo is Staphylococcus aureus. Let's zoom into the epidermis to see how it works. Remember that the basement membrane separates the epidermis to the dermis. Above the basement membrane, you have the stratum basale, which divides and divides, and as it divides, the cells will migrate up and lose its blood supply. On the very top of the epidermis, you have commensal microorganisms such as Staphylococcus aureus, which is again your normal microflora. For whatever reason, this bacteria Staphylococcus aureus can actually begin to invade the skin epidermal layer and go deeper into the epidermal layer. And this is in part because it releases a toxin called exfoliative toxin here in brown, which allows it to go deeper and deeper into the epidermis. Normally, your skin cells, your keratinocytes, are bound together by adhesion protein called desmosomes. If we were to zoom in to the top layer of the epidermis, such as your stratum corneum or your stratum granulosum, you can see that the skin cells are bound together by adhesion proteins called desmoglein 1. What Staphylococcus aureus can do is that it produces the exfoliative toxins here in brown, which actually breaks apart the adhesion proteins, thus disrupting the cell-to-cell adhesion, allowing the bacteria to infiltrate, to invade deeper into the epidermis. And as it invades deeper into the epidermis, it actually causes an inflammatory reaction. Neutrophils can come in, and thus it can also form a big blister, a bulla or a vesicle, or even a pustule. Again, just recapping, in the middle layer of the epidermis, you also get disruption of the adhesion proteins, as depicted here. However, the adhesion protein, the desmosome here in red, is not disrupted. This is because you have another type of desmosome found in the skin. This is not disrupted by the exfoliative toxins secreted by Staphylococcus aureus. And this desmosome in red is actually found in the bottom parts of the epidermis, such as the stratum basale. This desmosome is called desmoglein 3. And this is one of the reasons why impetigo doesn't involve sort of past the epidermal area. However, if the bacteria is able to go past the epidermal area, it can cause some complications. And these complications include cellulitis, which is infection of the dermal and subcutaneous tissue. If the bacteria that causes impetigo can sort of invade further, it can also enter the blood vessels, such as the capillaries, causing sepsis and bacteremia. Other complications of impetigo include glomerulonephritis, which is particularly caused by group A streptococcus, also known as strep pyogenes. In severe cases and rare cases, it can also cause osteomyelitis as a complication. Impetigo is diagnosed clinically, and investigations are not really needed. However, investigations can be ordered if complications are suspected. Investigations can include blood cultures and a blood workup. The management of impetigo is twofold. One, because impetigo is contagious, it's important to wash hands with soap. And two, if the child goes to school, for example, it's probably a good idea to keep them at home. Usually, impetigo is self-resolving and you don't need any pharmacological management. However, if you are concerned or if it's worsening, antibiotic, which is a pharmacological management, is used. First line is a topical antibiotic called mupirocin. Second line are penicillins, such as dicloxacillin and flucloxacillin. Let's now see how these antibiotics work. Remember, the main causative organisms of impetigo are gram-positive bacteria, such as Staphylococcus aureus and group A streptococcus. If you remember, gram-positive bacteria have a thick outer peptidoglycan layer and under it a plasma membrane. Within the bacteria, you also have ribosomes, which are these machinery workshops which make protein. They make protein by reading RNA, specifically mRNA, and by reading mRNA, they are able to produce proteins. Mupirocin works by reversibly inhibiting bacterial isoleucin tRNA synthetase. What does this mean? Well, tRNA is a protein which normally attaches to amino acids, such as in this case, isoleucine. It can attach together with the help of an enzyme, in this case, isoleucine tRNA synthetase. And because of this, this new tRNA isoleucine complex can go to the ribosome and can essentially offload the amino acids to help the ribosome make proteins. Mupirocin inhibits this enzyme, tRNA isoleucine synthetase, and thus disrupts protein synthesis. Penicillins work by binding onto penicillin-binding proteins on the cell wall and thus disrupts cell wall synthesis, which eventually leads to autolysis of the bacteria. If someone is hypersensitive to penicillins, such as they get some form of reaction, you use cephalosporins as an example. But interestingly, cephalosporins are also beta-lactams and actually work the same way as penicillins. So I hope you enjoyed this video on impetigo, which again is a contagious skin infection involving the epidermis. The main causative organisms are Staph aureus and group A streptococcus. It is usually self-resolving, but if concerned, you can use antibiotics, first line such as mupirocin, or penicillin such as dicloxacillin or flucloxacillin.